Hello, and welcome to another edition of Movies to Video Games Reviews. Today's video game based on a movie that we'll be reviewing is Batman Returns, made in 1992 by Konami for DOS-based computers. Batman Returns, made by Warner Brothers in 1992, was the follow-up to the very successful Batman film from 1989. The film brought back a lot of the same people behind and in front of the camera as it continued on in the adventures of the Dark Knight of Gotham City. This film was very successful. Fans rushed out to see the next installment as expectations were very high. The movie took in about $162 million in the US. Many video game versions of this movie were made to all the systems and computers on the market at the time. Instead of one big-name actor playing a villain, this time we had two, who would make up part of the big-name cast in this movie. Reprising his role as Batman and millionaire playboy Bruce Wayne was again jack-of-all-trades actor Michael Keaton. Playing the beautiful and mysterious feline cat-themed burglar Catwoman was attractive and highly sought-after Michelle Pfeiffer. As the grotesque and bird-loving, sewer-dwelling villain known as the Penguin, longtime TV and movie actor Danny DeVito. And as shrewd businessman of Gotham City, Max Schreck, portrayed by classic nervous-looking big-name movie star Christopher Walken. The movie starts out focusing on a crooked businessman, Max Schreck. While he is busy speaking to the people of Gotham City, the celebration is interrupted by a gang filled with circus performers. Cue the Batman, who comes in to save the day and take on the clowns and circus rejects. While Batman is taken on this gang, Max is taken into the sewers and meets up with the deformed and strange Penguin. Schreck decides to use Penguin as his own pawn and have him run for mayor, and the two start to work together in an evil alliance. Back in Schreck's office, his secretary, Selina Kyle, finds out about his plan to take advantage of Gotham City. Max tries to kill her off by pushing her out a window, only for her to survive. She's reborn as the now revenge-stricken Catwoman. While the rest of Gotham is falling for the Penguin's good guy image, Bruce Wayne is onto him and starts to investigate further into the true motives of both he and Max. Catwoman and Penguin team up and try to frame Batman and abduct a female model and have it look like Batman had killed her. Batman has to now escape from the police, who are now after him. This movie is full of adventure, action, and dark themes, and has Batman taking on the Penguin and Catwoman all the way through until the final climactic battle in the sewers. It's a great follow-up that won't disappoint from start to finish. It's the last game to be reviewed for Batman Returns-based games, and we finish it off with the computer version. So many different games based on this movie with mixed results. How will this one, made primarily for the computer, hold up? Stay tuned to find out, as it's time to get on to the review. Konami once again is behind a game based on this movie, and like the other games in the series made by them, this one for DOS will differ greatly from the other version. Made in a time when games for computers were made to be more sophisticated than a console type of video game, this game does change up gameplay mechanics greatly in this go-around due to that. Batman Returns for the computer is a point-and-click exploration game that has you cycling through various days in Gotham City during the events of the movie as you take the role of the Batman, who of course will be the only character you will use or have any control of for the entire game's run. You will be able to interact with areas of the Batcave, as well as venture out into the city via your Bat vehicles to try to find clues at various city locations that will lead you along the way to stop the Penguin's crime spree in the city before it's too late. The game doesn't use levels or stages like most Batman Returns games will. A day and hour system is used instead, where you have to accomplish certain goals in a given day before advancing to the next one. And you have 9 days to figure out all you're supposed to do to complete this game properly. You can clearly see what day and hour you're at in the pause screen that is loaded with the push of the escape button. This screen will also let you save, load, and exit the game or start a new one. More importantly, you can advance the clock ahead an hour with this screen, which is vital to do, as some missions will require Batman to go to locations at certain times to move the story along. As you load the game up, you are treated to the usual and expected Batman Returns logo screen, with music playing behind it. A brief credit roll will follow before we get to the still screen showing the bat signal over Gotham City. And just like that, the game begins. There's no backstory or clue as to where in the movie we are starting off at. So you're left to your own curiosity to try and figure out what to do as the game starts us out in the Batcave, with Batman standing in the center waiting for further direction from the would-be player. As you start out in Day 1, you are able to move about a yellow-colored Batman logo icon within the room. When the logo turns orange, you can interact with the area of the Batcave that you are currently hovering over. A lot of the game consists of moving the icon about with the mouse as you try to find the area you are interested in interacting with, and click on it to zoom into the section you are at to interact with more items or devices. The Batcave itself provides a few selections and is the main area of the game you will be doing most of your crime fighting. When you click on the main computer, for instance, you can then select four other screens that will lead to other options for you to interact with. And these are evidence. This will be where you analyze any items found at other locations for further clues on where to go next or for building a case against the Penguin. You can place the evidence into the computer, then view each item, and finally extrapolate to get the results of said items. Without finding the proper items and extrapolating, you can't further the story along properly. The next monitor at the main computer is the newscast, and this will have a GNN reporter telling you the latest news of the night. By watching it, you can also get a clue as to where you're to head to next, or it will sometimes have personal message from the Penguin taunting you. There's a database as well that you can interact with, and this will tell you a little bit about each character in the game, giving you information on who's who and any criminal activity that they are connected to. Lastly, there's a screen called Video, and this is where you can play back any videotapes found during your investigations throughout the city. By pushing play as you click on one of them, it will show you a short clip and lead you to your next location via what was just said on the tape. The other area of the Batcave that you can interact with is called the Vault, and this leads to two separate sections that you can go to. The first being a closet with spare costumes. As you take damage during your battles, your defensive or offensive stats on a particular suit will be lowered. When this happens, you can switch to one of the two backup costumes that restores your stats to full. More importantly will be the utility belt computer, where you can load up the belt with needed devices and weapons that you'll need to navigate and fight properly during the game's entire run. These are items like grapple, gauntlet, rope, lockpick, and scanner that are all non-fighting based and used automatically to move throughout the city locations. You can't do anything with them, but if you don't have them equipped in the utility belt, you won't be able to access certain areas when you arrive at certain locations. And then there are weapons that are all in the form of batarangs. You get standard batarangs, bolo batarangs, and sonic batarangs to choose from. And these weapons are used to stop enemies you come across during your investigations in the city. The only other options in the Batcave are to head to the garage where you automatically enter the Batmobile, or you can head back to Wayne Manor to end the day after you have accomplished all you feel you have to or could during that day's level. As you enter the garage, you then enter the Batmobile, and this will be the next main area of the game. And in the Batmobile, you can do two things. Watch the newscast of GNN, just as you could in the Batcave itself, and more importantly, select the map of Gotham City. And on this screen, you can choose where to go for your next investigation. A lot of the locations from the film are locations that you will be heading to. The map has places such as Old Gotham Zoo, Downtown, Main Plaza, Max Schreck's office, the Mayor's office, Penguin's hideout, and a fish market. You can also return to the Batcave via this map after you've finished exploring the various areas. Upon hearing the clues you pick up along the way, or via newscast, you can guess to where you're supposed to be heading to next. Sometimes it will be as simple as going to the mayor's office and collecting an item laying on the desk. Other times it'll be going to the old zoo to pick up event posters laying around. It's quite simplistic, actually, how basic it all comes off. As mentioned earlier, there are fighting moments in this game, and they are very basic and uneventful moments, actually. Sometimes on the street-based locations, you will be attacked by one of the Red Triangle Circus gang members, who are the only enemies you will really confront in this entire game, and I use the word confront very lightly. The clowns are limited in who you will see, and the usual lot. The Fat Clown, the Fire Clown, and the Acrobatic Clown. Both Batman and one of these clowns will move back and forth in front of each other, and you can select fighting styles from normal or fierce, and the computer having both characters exchanging random blows as they get close to one another. After this, you can then select one of your weapons equipped in your utility belt to end the battle quickly and easily. Select one of the batarangs, and then when the players move far enough away from each other, it will automatically get thrown and take down the enemy for good. Batman can then interrogate the enemy, giving you the option of asking one question to the fallen clown. The right choice has to be made to get the proper evidence or information needed to move the story along. And that's all fighting moments come down to. Select your fighting style, select what batarang you want to use, the game does the rest of the work for you. Each day will consist of various tasks that you have to do and properly, so that you can progress in the proper sequence in the next day. So, for instance, you have to go to the fish market a few days in a row, waiting for the owner of said store to tell you who's buying a certain fish that Batman got a clue about earlier. Once you get the information, you'll know where to go for your next location. You don't always know if you're progressing properly, though, as you have various days to get things done, and the game does seem to allow for you to be able to do tasks later on than the earliest point they're available. But if you do forget to do something, or not go to the right location when you were supposed to, the game will suddenly show the you lose cutscene, meaning you have to do it over again. So there's a bit of a challenge to the game overall when playing the first few times, as you learn what the proper places to go and what items are supposed to be gotten from where. While there's no story per se found in the game, it still has a weird way of tying things in properly to the events of the film. Seeing the movie will help tie things together here. For instance, when the Penguin is giving his classic speech at City Hall, you have to start watching it on GNN TV in the Batcave, then exit out of the TV as you're watching it, and load the video screen, and then know to play the video footage you recorded earlier while he was taunting you in the Batmobile earlier that day. It was a nice nod like that that did give a movie feel to this, and it came off almost exactly as it did in the film, strangely enough. There was a lot of interesting usage of movie moments in locations like that. All the locations were here that mattered, like the Batcave, the street in front of the department store, the old zoo, Penguin's hideout. As basic and simplistic as the game is, it still had a weird way of tying everything to the film that it's based on somehow. Even the characters themselves look spot on, almost taking a perfect digitized image of all the key actors and having them show up either in cutscene or video footage on one of the tapes Batman can watch, looking almost identical to the actors portraying them. For such a weird offshoot type of game, they sure paid a lot of attention to details. Whether it was Michael Keaton, Danny DeVito, or Pat Hingle, who played Commissioner Gordon, they were perfectly represented here in the game. The only real omission was Michelle Pfeiffer's Catwoman having very little screen time in the entire game, only showing up for the last moments in a blink moment and cutscene at that. The game is actually quite easy, perhaps the simplest of all the Batman Returns games that I've already reviewed. The only challenge is figuring out what you're supposed to be looking for and where it's located, and then once it's found, to bring it back to the Batcave to have it analyzed as evidence. And once you figure that out, it's an hour at most game that you'll have little to no trouble playing and completing with very little challenge offered. Other problems with the game is there's really not that much to do. You are clicking on various things here and there, but most of the game does the work for you as you sit by and watch it. Even longer moments in most games based on this film, like the circus train with the firstborn, for instance, is reduced to just a simple visit to the city and a fight against a mindless clown to complete that whole story element. The Penguin taking over the Batmobile is reduced to you sitting and watching him taunt you on the news screen. The Ice Princess and fighting the cops moments found in other games based on this movie are not even here. Controls are also just as easy as can be expected in this type of game. You point at an area, wait for the icon to turn orange, click on it with the mouse button. If you can click once every now and then and move the mouse about, you can more than handle the controls with this game. Fighting couldn't be any easier, with you just selecting the type of batarang you want and sitting there waiting for it to happen. I honestly just wish there was more to do here. The player actually winds up doing very little when all is said and done. Graphically, the game looks great considering the time it was made. As mentioned before, the digitized moments with the actors being shown look perfect and are recognizable when compared to the movie. The locations that we are ventured to all look proper and right, and have this simplistic few color scheme to them, while keeping the dark feel and atmosphere of the movie at the same time. The cutscenes that would show up, sometimes during gameplay, also had a nice look and detailed style to them, capturing the feel and moment from the film well in the still seen moments with text under it. There was no vocals or animations of the game due to the time when it was made, I assume, but with what they had to work with, they handled the look and feel aspects quite well. Even if the rest of the game is a bit limiting overall. Being that the game is simplistic and short as stated many times, with it only taking 9 game days to beat, it doesn't have much to talk about as far as boss situations go. There was a strong man you would deal with, and even the Penguin would be fought earlier on in the game, but both are beaten the same way as anyone else's. Just choose a batarang and throw it to take them down or chase them away. In my playthrough, Catwoman never even shows up in a fight or mentioned until the end of the game. After you get through the proper order of events in the earlier days and ruin Penguin's chances to become mayor during day 8, you then go for the overall win in day 9. You will have a cutscene showing the party that Penguin crashes, as he mentions he's going to take the city's firstborn, and then kidnaps Max Schreck as well. Batman will be given a chance to hand over the evidence to the commissioner during the party. For some reason you shouldn't, as there is nothing the cops can do about it. You are now using the Batski, instead of the Batmobile, to chase down the Penguin, similar to what happened in the movie. But even the Batski works exactly as the Batmobile did, with you being able to travel anywhere on the map within it. You first have to stop the train with the kids in the main area of the city by going to said location and taking down one easy to deal with clown. Then it's off to stop the Penguin at the zoo. You're instantly thrusted into the final battle, which again is just throwing some random batarangs at him. He will fall into the water and be finished just like that. Catwoman then shows up and electrocutes Max Schreck again, as per the movie, and Batman just drives off after saving the city. And that's how the game ends. But that's just one of the endings you can get in this game. The game had another little twist to it in that you can get various endings depending on what you did or didn't do in it. Most of the other endings are losing endings, meaning you didn't do the right things and therefore lost the game. There's an ending that you get by pushing the eject button in the Batmobile. An ending for not properly interfering with the Penguin's speech for mayor. And just a general losing ending if you didn't go to the right place at the right time. There's also another good ending besides the one talked about previously that has Catwoman and Batman going off happily together at the end rather than the tragic fate that befell her. So there's a few ways to end this game or have the game end suddenly. However you end the game, it's still very short and without any credits, with the credits being viewed at the start of the game anyway. And once you do beat it properly, there's really no need to ever play this game again as there's no challenge or thrill left in this adventure. Yep, that's it, alright. One thing the game has a lot of is music filling the background while you go from moment to moment, and all the music was instrumental and based off the soundtrack done by Danny Elfman. And it did add to the feel and tone of the game quite well, considering you were just clicking a few times here and there. At least the music kept everything tied in though. While you were driving the vehicle, you heard the triumphant Batman theme as you're racing to the next location. As you're sneaking about, you hear music fitting to that. It was used quite effectively, and I only wish that other games based on this film used the soundtrack as this one did, as this is the way to do it. This game is different, and that doesn't make it bad, but it honestly doesn't make it great either. I understand that PC gaming in the 80s and 90s had to be more than just a copy of a console game for the most part to cater to a usually different audience that is using said computer. But the game just doesn't give the game player enough to do as we sit there watching everything be done and spelled out for us as we navigate through it by pointing and clicking here and there. And honestly, the game isn't bad at all for what it's worth. It's a true detective mystery solving type of adventure that fits a Batman situation so well. But that would have been more for something out of a comic book story. For Batman Returns, which has a lot of action and Tim Burton's dark style to it, this just didn't work as well as it could have in this format. The game is also way too easy, and the replayability is so low that there's no point in playing the game once you have figured out everything you're supposed to do to complete it properly. The first few times going in without knowing what to do and where to go to get through it, it's fun to figure that out and find all the hidden items and sort through them in the back computer. But after that, there's really no need to ever play this game ever again. I did enjoy the graphics, and the music of the game was great too, and wish other games based on the film were to those standards. And it's kind of sad that the game that does these two aspects so well doesn't have much game to go along with it. It's definitely one of those check it out as it's just so different, as some may like it more than others for its uniqueness, as it's nothing like the other games based on this movie. But I think some of the console versions still get it closer to the feel of the film. It's an interesting way to end it with something so different from anything else in the series. Well, with that all said, it's time to put this movie to rest once and for all. And this PC-based game is gonna wind up getting a... That's all for this edition of Movies to Video Games Reviewed. Please be sure to check back soon for our next video game based on a movie review.